Welcome to, or back to, Forgotten Hollywood, the channel where I take you back in time to show you the movies, shows, and actors that have faded over the years. The last few years have shown a string of biopics. Bohemian Rhapsody, Rocket Man, and most recently Elvis, take us back to witness the lives of famous singers. But where did the biopics start? Whose lives were the first recorded on film? Let's find out. While I normally focus on American cinema, as that's what I primarily know, the first biopic was actually Australian. The story of the Kelly Gang was released in 1906, 3 years before the first American film of its kind. Before any other film of its kind, actually. Biopics really started to be produced around 1909 and continued with at least one a year until 1924. The earliest biopics in America were about the lives of biblical figures. There was also a film made about General Custer in 1912, but it was about as historically accurate as Mother Goose. This leads me to an important point. What makes a film a biopic? Broken down, biopic means biographical motion picture. In other words, it is a film based in history that covers a span of time, usually several years, to tell about the life of a historical figure. This is different from the historical drama that focuses on a single time or event in a person's life, and the historical fiction that might be inspired by history, but doesn't include actual events as they happened. One could argue that, with the amount of liberties taken, Custer's last fight would be closer to historical fiction than a biopic. In recent years, the same argument could be made for Hamilton. There was something interesting in a film from 1914 called Home Sweet Home. It included a title card featuring a paragraph about how creative license was taken when it came to the life of the subject, the poet John Howard Payne. These days, we don't expect Hollywood to be completely accurate. Directors and writers do feel the need to build up drama. But back then, they had no frame of reference for such liberties. Beyond the historical content, there is the matter of time. Many films are erroneously called biopics when they are really historical dramas. Films like Titanic, Apollo 13, Pearl Harbor, and Ford vs. Ferrari are all historical films, but not biopics. Each follows a series of events in a localized point in history. While each has main characters, there is not one central character that the story is following. In contrast, movies like The Babe often begin with the main character's childhood, then move into the trials and triumphs of their adult lives. But even if the childhood is only referenced, as in The King's Speech, the film can still be a biopic, if the events are varied and span several years. MacArthur begins when the subject is already a military leader, but goes over 10 years of his life and career. You see, biographies don't pick a single point in time. They cover the subject's life. And the same is true for a biopic. Let's look at some examples. As previously mentioned, biopics about entertainers, such as actors, singers, and musicians, have been a popular topic for decades. One such film is Yankee Doodle Dandy. In this 1942 musical, James Cagney plays George M. Cohan and tells the story of his rise from small-town vaudeville to headlining Broadway. The movie literally covers his life from birth to a few years before his death.
Well, here I am going on like Tennyson's Brook giving you the story of my life. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. You should have stopped me.
Although the filmmakers couldn't have known that as he died just 5 months after the release of the film. It includes a common feature of biopics, starting at the end before going back to the beginning. This establishes who the subject is with early narration before the film itself begins to play. However, this feature is not exclusive to biopics, as it can be seen in fiction as well, such as It's a Wonderful Life and Big Trouble in Little China. Another popular topic for biopics are great leaders, be it military, political, or religious. One of my favorite modern biopics is The Young Victoria.
You're unprepared.
No experience. I'm too young.
they don't know you like I do.
Released in 2009 and starring Emily Blunt, the film covers the childhood and early reign of Queen Victoria, her time as a princess, her ascension, her marriage, and starting a family. Yes, it did tweak a few details for the sake of drama, but there is one thing it got right that I love. It may sound weird, but it's the hair. Ladies' hairstyles in period films are notoriously modern. But in The Young Victoria, great pains were taken to ensure the ladies sported period hairstyles. I can forgive a few alterations to the timeline when it is clear that the filmmakers did their research and put in the effort to be true to history. Unlike some others, but I digress. Speaking of creative license, one such film jumps right to the top of the list. It falls under the category of entrepreneurs, biopics about men and women who made their fortunes as pioneers in various forms of business and industry, such as Steve Jobs, Henry Ford, and Nikola Tesla. One of my favorites, and you might find this weird after I was just going off about historical accuracy, is The Greatest Showman. In this musical, Hugh Jackman stars as Phineas Taylor Barnum, a lovable rascal seeking his fortune to provide a good life for his family. Pretty far off the mark from the real P.T. Barnum. However, I give the film a pass for one reason. It's a movie that lies and exaggerates to tell the life story of a man who made his living by lying and exaggerating. Now.
I just ask how heavy you are. Do you have a number for that?
I prefer not to say,
just
but...
Just between you and me, 500 pounds. 750 pounds?
750 pounds!
What is your name?
Vasily Palavro, sir.
Yeah, we're gonna change that name. I think you're Irish.
No, it doesn't follow an accurate timeline, but the major events in the movie involving P.T. did happen. No, it doesn't depict specific performers, but his biggest acts were all represented. It has the bad habit of making the 19th century women look like they belong in the 21st century. Okay, that part doesn't get a pass. We know what the women looked like. You could at least make an effort for accuracy. Other than that, it is a most enjoyable use of creative license to tell about one of America's favorite liars. The final popular category for a biopic is sports. I can name at least half a dozen in this group without giving the matter much thought, but I would like to focus on a great example from 1993. Rudy. Starring Sean Astin, known today as Samwise Gamgee, the story follows Daniel Rudy Rudiger, a struggling student who dreams of playing football for the University of Notre Dame. He faces setbacks, heartaches, and learning disability, but he presses on towards the goal line and doesn't listen to anyone who uses the words, "you can't."
What's wrong?
Read it.
Congratulations. You are...
I did it.
You did it. You did it. Hey, guys. My son's going to Notre Dame.
All right, Rudy, way to go.
It's truly an inspiring story of hard work and dedication, one I highly recommend. Whether it's the King of Rock or the King of England, an inventor or an athlete, some lives are so extraordinary, their stories need to be told. Biopics don't just give facts, they give an impression of the person. They inspire the audience to Reach for the stars. Stand strong. Take chances. And never give up. It's more than just a story because it's true. These people really lived. These things did happen. And that is why this style of film has captured audiences for over 100 years and will continue to do so for many more to come. Thanks for watching. Which of the biopics I mentioned was your favorite? Or did I miss yours? If you like this kind of content, please like and subscribe, and don't forget to click the bell for notifications. Let me know in the comments if there is any trope or film style you'd like to see featured, and I will catch up with you next time.